on Friday, it is International Women's Day. And although things have got better for women over the last decade or so, it's still far from perfect. That's why all this week we have been listening in to conversations between young women and their female role models. And they've been talking about the traditionally male-dominated professions that they work in, what problems that can sometimes cause and how they deal with it. Today, we're going to be talking about politics. And it's actually something which I often mention on the programme, because I don't know about you, but I do sometimes find the House of Commons quite a masculine environment. You know, all that jeering and shouting and kind of over-the-top, aggressive, theatrical behaviour. You know, from an outsider's point of view, I don't know, it doesn't always seem that welcoming. Anyway, we got together two politics lovers for a chat. First of all, Tess Michaels is a third-year politics student from the University of Sussex. And she is in conversation with the MP for Chichester, Gillian Keegan.
I think there's maybe an unconscious bias in many industries that I've worked in, and certainly in politics, where, you know, people gain an image of people. You know, what does an MP look like? And yeah, if you ask people to imagine an MP, in certain cases they would think of a man in a three-piece suit who maybe studied politics or something like this. So those, the people do have unconscious bias, and the Conservative Party is actually, It is, the members of the party are a little bit older than the average population, yeah, so they do tend to also have, in some cases, have more traditional attitudes about roles for men and women. So you have to kind of overcome that a little bit. Now, they're not deliberately trying to be obstructive, but you maybe have to update their thinking a little bit.
Yeah. Is there anything else that you think could stop women wanting to run to be an MP?
Well, there's lots of things. I would imagine most of what would... So the first thing is the lifestyle itself. So there's obviously very... I mean, there's been a lot of work to try and improve this, but still, the hours are, tend to be quite long. You live in two places in many cases, unless you're a London MP. So you have to move from place to place, which may or may not suit your family. And even the idea of public speaking, you know, if you go... I mean, you're at university studying now, but if you go around in your class and ask people, you know, how they feel about public speaking, you know, 9 out of 10 people are terrified of public speaking. And it's very natural to be terrified of public speaking, but that is a huge part of the job.
I think it's really interesting. It is often sort of the men on my course who feel much more confident public speaking as well than women.
Yeah, I think, well, in my experience, men tend to feel a little bit more confident about quite a lot of things. I don't know what it is. But it does tend to, I mean, this is quite generalist, but from what I've seen, you know, men do tend to have maybe a little less self-doubt. We tend to ask ourselves a lot more questions. I don't know if you feel like that, but I certainly, took me a long time to get my confidence.
Do you ever feel like you're being spoken over when you're trying to debate or in the House of Commons or just speaking to your colleagues in general?
Yes, I have to tell you. So the West Sussex MPs, of which there's 8, I'm the only female, and I'm the first female MP for Chichester and the first female MP for the Conservatives in West Sussex. Yeah. So at the first meeting, you know, it used to be, you know, a group of just guys, and it's been like that since 1295. I don't know if they did these meetings then, but they certainly in Chichester have been sending an MP since that time. And they, at the first meeting we were talking, and it was a particular subject, and it was about transport, so rail and roads came up, and obviously Chichester, there's a lot to talk about in those areas. And because I was new, I tended to hold back a little bit and was a little, you know, waited my turn. And it was an hour meeting. And just, I guess, about the last 10 minutes of the meeting, I decided I'd sort of say something. I'd literally spoken for less than 30 seconds. And one of the MPs said, oh, well, we're a bit short of time now. And basically just cut me off. And I thought, OK, it's now or never. And I just said, I cannot believe you've just done that. Honestly, we've been speaking for an hour. You've all spoken for 10 minutes each. I've literally opened my mouth at the first meeting for 30 seconds. And you've mansplained me. How on earth does that happen? And I did. did. And honestly, he was mortified. And we're actually very good friends now. But he was absolutely mortified. And I think, you know, using humour to set boundaries is a very effective way, actually, in anything, in politics, in business. Because sometimes people don't realise they're doing, or sometimes they do realise it. But, you know, if you're gonna take someone on, it's always best to try and leave them with a shred of dignity at the end of it, if it's in front of other people anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, do you find that in your lectures? Is that something that's obvious?
Yeah, I think it is. There is often sort of the boys in the class do tend to speak more. I think even when you know you've got something really good to say, you sort of try and hold back because you're worried you might be wrong, which you shouldn't really. It's a seminar, you're all meant to be learning. Yeah, I think it is definitely, people do tend to talk over you more as a woman as well, I think.
Yeah. And I think you just said, you know, in case you're wrong, you know, I'm the same. I sort of sit there and think, oh, do I want to speak on this? I don't really know, you know, tons about it. Mm. I don't feel ready yet. I feel like I need to research it a bit more. I need to go meet a few more people. But whereas many people just say, oh, well, you know, I know enough. I'll just, you know, everybody's been waiting to hear, you know, my thoughts on this subject. And, you know, it's a different approach and a different attitude.
Do you think there's any other ways that you're treated differently from your male colleagues?
Yes. I mean, you know, there's a lot of positive things as well, you know. Mm. So you know, Parliament can be a very courteous place as well. So, you know, sometimes, you know, you feel like you're, the common courtesies afforded to women are, you know, are very good. You know, colleagues are do tend to be polite when talking to you. But, you know, the whole sort of adversarial nature of party politics, you know, where you've got people sat opposite each other, sort of trying to shout you down or trying to put you off. That is an environment that takes some getting used to. And it's not a natural environment for anybody, but it is one that, well, certainly public school boys seem to thrive in it.
But, it does strike you as being very sort of traditionally masculine when you're watching it on TV.
And you still hear more men. You'd still hear more males' voices.
Yeah.
And they're the ones who tend to do, you know, more of the sort of heckling type of stuff as well. You very rarely hear the women heckling quite the same way. It's just, in some ways, actually, it looks awful from the TV. It's actually quite funny sometimes when you're in there because, you know, they do come up with something quite quick-witted sometimes. There was one the other day and somebody said something said, you know, the Prime Minister and I don't always see eye to eye. And the chap who said it actually isn't that tall. This somebody shouted out, well, that's because she's a foot taller than you, or something like that. You know, so they do, you know, they are quite funny.
And we'll bring you the second part of that conversation between the MP for Chichester, Gillian Keegan, and Tess Michaels, a third-year politics student from the University of Sussex, after this. Blondie and the Tide is High. You're listening to Alison Ferns on BBC Sussex and BBC Surrey. Blondie and the Tide is High. You're listening to Alison Ferns on BBC Sussex and BBC Surrey, and you join us halfway through a conversation between the MP for Chichester, Gillian Keegan, and third-year politics student from the University of Sussex, Tess Michaels. The whole point of this whole series this week is to shine a light on some of the professions that tend to be quite male dominated. We've been listening to conversations between younger women hoping to kind of get into that world and their female career role models. And here, Gillian and Tess discuss the world of social media.
When I first stood in St Helens, which was in 2015, so it's where I'm from in Liverpool. I'm from Liverpool originally. And I tried, I stood there first and it wasn't really a conservative area. In fact, it's definitely not a conservative area. And, you know, the first time I set up a Facebook page and I did a survey to, you know, look at what the local issues were, and I would update people on campaigns on Facebook. And, you know, you sort of, you wake up and you have a look at your Facebook and then you see all these comments and they're all telling you how you're, you know, rich, privileged, you know, posh Tory. And actually I was, you know, from a street just round the corner that they were, that went to the normal comprehensive school round the corner as well, and they had completely didn't know anything about me, but they just assumed because I was conservative that I was privileged. And the first time you get it, I hardly slept the next night. It really, really bothered me. But it's the same with all the things I said about practice. You know, actually, the more you get it, the more you do become a little numb to it, because it's all the same. You know, it's all how useless you are, what a waste of space, how unlucky the people are that have you to represent them as being this awful person. And they're all kind of the same. They're not even smart criticism.
Do you think you get more of that sort of online harassment because you're a woman, or do you think
definitely and it will always be about how you look. That'll be thrown in there as well, either, you know, what you're wearing or how you look. And I don't know, and actually even from women and men, you know, they have lots of opinions, and I don't know why they seem, but they do seem to, you know, women do seem to suffer from much more abuse online, women politicians in particular. And I don't know why, but I guess it's because at the heart of it is bullying behaviour. And I guess they largely think that we'll be intimidated more, perhaps. But, you know, even though I said, you know, the first time I saw it, I was very, you know, really upset, and it did play on my mind. You do get very much sort of hardened to it, which is not nice in a way, but you do kind of put it into context and think, oh, this is just somebody that normally they've got about three followers themselves. So it's not as if they've got a wide audience listening to their rants. And that's part of their problem. And what about you? Do you have all that on social media? I mean, is it just for reserved for politicians, or do you? Because I've noticed with like head teachers and even the woman who runs our, we've got a lot of really brilliant female leaders actually in West Sussex. The leader of West Sussex County Council, the leader of the Hospital Trust, and the leader of the Mental Health Hospital Trust. They're all women, and the University Vice Chancellor. So there's a lot of really great women, and I've spoken to many of them, and they get it as well, which I was quite surprised. I thought it was more for politicians. But do you find it yourself? Does it?
I mean, I don't have a massive social media presence, and I always try not to be too political or controversial, but sort of for that reason, you do worry that people will sort of say horrible things to you online, I think. And I think it does affect lots of women from every walk of life, really.
That was Gillian Keegan, MP for Chichester, and Tess Michaels, a third-year politics student from the University of Sussex.